Father God, we just come to you this morning. We just lift up the name of Jesus here this morning. Father, I just ask you that as we just come to you, no matter what the circumstances are in our life, that if we feel that we've been blessed, that we would praise your name, Lord. And if we feel that we're just suffering persecution and suffering hardship, Lord, that we would still be able to bless the name of Jesus. Lord, you do take away. But we want our prayer this morning to be, blessed be the name of Jesus. So, Father God, I just ask you that just no matter what the circumstances are of each individual here this morning, that we would just look to you as the author and the finisher of our faith. We would recognize, Father, that you are God and you are holy, that you have given us life, that you created each and every one of us. And what you want back from us is for us to give our lives back to you and to serve you wholeheartedly. So, Lord, I just ask that you would just be with every part of this service here this morning. You would just bless the time that as we sing praises unto your name, that you tell us in your word, Lord, that you inhabit our praise. So we just thank you and praise you for that. And Lord, as we just continue to sing praises to you, that you would just be preparing our hearts for the hearing of the message here this morning, for the hearing of the spoken word of God. And that would truly, when we leave this place this morning, we can say it was good to be in the house of God. And Lord, I just ask you that you would just help us to reach out and just show love to those around us. And Lord, just as we reach out to those around us, that we would just be sensitive to the needs of people, that we would just point them to you. That everything about our lives, the way we live our lives, the things that we say, the things that we do, would just point people to Jesus. And we just thank you and praise you for all these things in your dear precious name. Amen.
Your grace, everlasting, your light will shine. Thank you. You know, we've been working our way through Nehemiah, and we're arriving this week at Nehemiah chapter 3. And I got to tell you, I was a little apprehensive about Nehemiah chapter 3. From reading Nehemiah before, I know the story, I know how it goes. And chapter 1 is, we get the image of Nehemiah as he receives this burden from God for the people of Israel, the people of Jerusalem, and for the city of Jerusalem. And when he hears the news that the walls have fallen in, that the people are in disarray, he falls down, he just cries, he just weeps, and he begins to pray and fast before God for the city of Jerusalem and for its people. And that prompted him, that led him to begin preparation for the ministry, for the mission that God had given him. And so, through the rest of Nehemiah chapter 1 and through Nehemiah chapter 2, we're looking at him preparing for the mission that God had given him. And as we looked last week, we looked at the first steps that he took on the mission. And this week, when we get to Nehemiah chapter 3, it is about the mission. It is about the building of the walls. And I know from reading Nehemiah chapter 3 that it's a lot of names and it's a lot of places. Chuck Swindoll wrote a book, and I think it's called Hand Me Another Brick. And it's on the book of Nehemiah. And he dedicates, you know, each chapter contains just a part of a chapter of the book. But when he gets to Nehemiah chapter 3, he dedicates one chapter to it, and he basically says they built the wall. And so when I was nervous about it, thinking, how am I going to preach on this basically the plan that they used in building the wall? But as I opened it up this week and I began to study, I was just absolutely overwhelmed by the incredible truth in Nehemiah chapter 3 regarding the mission, completing the mission that has been given to Nehemiah, and completing the mission that has been given to us. Let me tell you, there is so much in there, so much truth, so much for us to learn as we consider what our mission is. And our mission collectively as a body of believers, but also our mission as individuals. The mission that God has given you specifically. And we're going to look at that today. And I think you're going to be blessed by God's word and the truth and what it has to say about the mission that God has prepared for you. And before we open His Word, let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, we thank You this morning that we have this privilege of coming together. And Lord, we especially thank You for the privilege it is to possess Your Word, to possess the Word of God, the very truth that came from Your mouth, that came from Your finger. And this morning, Lord, I just pray that You just touch us in a special way with the truth of Your Word. That God, whatever it is that we came here with, whatever mountain sits before us, whatever challenge we face, whatever mission it is, Lord, that sits in front of us in ruins, Lord, You've got a plan for rebuilding. And I pray this morning, God, that You speak to us regarding that, and we are changed as a result of the time we spend in Your Word. We just thank You, we look forward to that, and we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, we're going to look at Nehemiah chapter 3, and we're going to go the whole way through the chapter this morning. And so what we're going to do is we are going to work our way through it, kind of one verse at a time. I'm not going to read through the whole thing right away, but we will read through the entire thing here as we walk through Nehemiah chapter 3. So I want you to turn to chapter 3, and we're going to start right there at verse 1. And verse 1 says this, it says, Eliashib the high priest and his fellow priests went to work and rebuilt the sheep gate. They dedicated it and set its doors in place, building as far as the tower of the hundred, which they dedicated, and as far as the tower of Hananel. You know, I don't know if the book of Nehemiah chapter 3 was written in chronological order or not. I don't know if this is the first thing that happened, but it's the first thing that he wrote. So I'm going to make the assumption that it's the first thing that happened. And I want us to look at this mission to complete the walls. They didn't contact someone for a feasibility study. They didn't look for masons, a group of masons to come in and do the work of building the wall. I want us to consider they began the wall by sending the priests. The priests were the first ones out the door. There was a huge task in front of them to rebuild this fallen city of Jerusalem, to restore hope to the people of Israel. And the first thing that happened was the priests were out the door doing their part to build. And I want us to consider this today as our first point. And it is that spiritual leaders led the mission. The first people to get engaged, to become active, to become a part of the rebuilding process were the spiritual leaders of Jerusalem. They were the ones that were going to set the pace for the rest of the city. The rest of the people maybe were sitting back, apprehensive, not sure what to do. Should we begin this work or not? Remember last week, they said, let us rise up and build. And now the spiritual leaders are the first ones out the door. And we need to learn from that. That it should be the spiritual leaders that are leading the task, the mission, whatever it might be. We need godly leaders, people who are not afraid to get out in front and do the work. You know, the church today, I think, has really got a messed up view of church leadership. And I'm not talking about Crossview. I'm talking about the church in general. We have molded church leadership today to look more like corporate leadership. We've gone to the model of corporate leadership and we've kind of adopted that into our church. And yet, when we look at Nehemiah, I don't see Donald Trump and all involved in this. This was the spiritual leaders of the city. They were the ones that were going to lead the way. And we need that same thing in taking on the tasks and taking on the missions that God has given us to do. You know, we get the idea that church leadership today is sitting in a boardroom making decisions. And there is certainly an element of that. That's an important aspect of church leadership. But when I look at the examples from Scripture, that's not the model that I see. I see church leaders who were out in front leading the way. They were involved in the mission. They were not only involved, they weren't only supporting the mission, they were leading the mission. And that's what we need in our leadership today. We need people who are willing to get out front, to by example lead. On your bulletin today, there's a quote from John Stott, and he says this, the authority by which Christian leaders lead is not power, but love. Not force, but example. Not coercion, but reason, persuasion. Leaders have power, but power is safe only in the hands of those who humble themselves to serve. We need leaders who are willing to be humble servants. And you know what? When people do that, when leaders do that, people will get behind them and they'll follow them. And that's the example from Nehemiah in restoring the walls of Jerusalem. The spiritual leaders led the charge. And then in verse 2, it says this, the men of Jericho built the adjoining section, and Zakur, son of Imri, built next to them. You know, there's a phrase in verse 2 that's found in the Bible 18 times, but it's found 15 times in chapter 3 of Nehemiah. And that is the phrase, next to him. And in fact, there's another variation on that. Next to them also appears 6 more times, I believe. So 24 times in the book of Nehemiah, it says either next to him or next to them. And what is he trying to convey to us? The fact that there was a perimeter around the city. This wall went the whole way around the city. It was over 2 miles long. And in order to cover every inch of that wall, to cover every aspect, every part of that wall, it meant that there was going to be somebody here. And next to him, there was going to be somebody here. And next to him was going to be somebody else. And the picture that we get is that the mission was a community effort. It was not going to be done by one family. It wasn't going to be done by only the church leaders. It wasn't going to be done only by the deacons. It was going to be done by everyone. It was a community effort. It was the responsibility of everyone to see that the walls were put back together. You know, mission is never intended to occur in isolation. A mission may be specific for you, but it is not only for you. Whatever your mission is, God has people that He wants to be a part of that. He wants people to help you, to assist you, to be a part of the mission. Remember, He went out and He assembled His team. The words of William Carey, "I'll go down if you hold the ropes." You can't possibly hope to do a mission independently. We as a church, I see that unfold right here. The whole next to Him, the next to them philosophy I see in this church. If you look back here in the sound booth, we have the McKnights on videography, and next to him, Roger Thomas as the sound man, and next to him, the Boozles are greeting people at the door. And next to him, the Corneliuses were leading the worship. And next to him, go all the way through the church. It is not about one person. It's not about one group of people. It is about a community of believers that are committed to one purpose. When we think about our overall objective of building the church, our overall objective of bringing people to Christ, that's our overall mission. But that is accomplished by each of us faithfully doing our part. Finding the piece of wall that is our responsibility and focusing on that piece of wall. It's a community effort. It's not just for the pastor, for the worship team. You know, wouldn't you just love it if one Sunday the worship team, which consists of what, 8 people or so, if maybe just, I don't know, Faith showed up and we sang to the drums. You know, it wouldn't go too well, would it? And it wouldn't go too well if just the bassist showed up. It requires every person doing their part, and it makes incredibly good music. And the same thing is true about our ministry, our mission. We each have a part to play. It's a community effort. And if we turn back to Nehemiah chapter 3, verses 4 and 5, it says, they laid its beams and put its doors, we'll start in verse 3. The fish gate was rebuilt by the sons of Hasanah. They laid its beams and put its doors and bolts and bars in place. Meremoth, son of Uriah, the son of Hakaz, repaired the next section. Next to him, Meshullam, son of Berechiah, the son of Hezebel, made repairs. And next to him, Zadok, son of Banah, also made repairs. The next section was repaired by the men of Tekoa. But their nobles would not put their shoulders to the work under their supervisors. You know, I gotta love those folks from Tekoa. When I read this and I hear the guys from Tekoa, it says that their nobles, it means their leaders, the leaders of Tekoa said, you know what, I'm not gonna be involved in that. And yet, even though their leaders took that perspective, the people of Tekoa said, you know what, I want to be a part of that mission. And they left Tekoa and they went to Jerusalem to be about the building of the walls. They were not going to stop the mission because their leaders refused to be a part of it. Now, it doesn't tell us why they didn't want to be a part of it. But they didn't. They very well, you know what, that's beneath me. I can't lift rocks. I'm not gonna waste my time. Or they may, you know what, we've got enough problems in Tekoa. Why in the world am I going to go over to Jerusalem? I hear that today. And yet, the people of Tekoa, in spite of that, said, you know what? This is a mission that I want to be a part of. And they went and they became a part of the work that was going on in Jerusalem. They were not going to be stopped from being a part of the mission. And you know, when leaders fail to lead, our responsibility, your responsibility, is to do what God has called you to do. If Dan, Pastor Dan, refuses to take you where God has called us to go, you have a responsibility to step forward and take us there. And the same could be said about any other leader in the church. That doesn't mean we subvert leadership. We need to support leadership. The leadership that is not obedient to God is not leadership. You know, there's a tendency when we're working at our part of the wall, when we're focused on what's in front of us and we see somebody next to us who isn't doing their part, that becomes a distraction. And all of a sudden, we're not looking at our part of the wall. We're looking at the guy next to us going, you know what? He should be doing something. He's not doing what he's called to do. What did the men from Tekoa do? They could have been distracted. They could have said, you know what? Our leaders aren't going. I'm not going either. They're not going to do their part. I'm not going to do my part. And yet they went forward and they did what they were supposed to do. The workers were not distracted by those who refused to help. And when you take your eyes and place them on the guy next to you who's not doing his part, your eyes have been removed from the wall that's in front of you. You are no longer looking at what God has called you to focus on. You're focusing on somebody else and something else. All that's going to do is distract you from what you've been called to do. You know what? We need to encourage people who aren't carrying their load. We need to encourage people who are not involved in ministry. But that gives us no out from doing what we've been called to do. You are still responsible to do the ministry that God has given you, and you need to focus solely on that. What wall is it that God has put in front of you? You cannot remain focused on your own task when your primary concern is somebody else's task. What has God called you to do? Faithfully, in complete obedience and effort, do that. And allow God to deal with maybe those who aren't sharing their part of the load. That's our responsibility, is to do completely what God has given us to do. Turn back to Nehemiah chapter 3, beginning at verse 6. The Jeshanah gate was repaired by Jehoiada, son of Paseah, and Meshullam, son of Besadiah. They laid its beams and put its doors and bolts and bars in place. Next to them, repairs were made by men from Gibeon and Mizpah, Malatia of Gibeon, and Jadon of Meronoth, places under the authority of the governor of Trans-Euphrates. Uzziel, son of Hanani, one of the goldsmiths, repaired the next section, and Hananiah, one of the perfume makers, made repairs next to that. They restored Jerusalem as far as the broad wall. Rephaiah, son of Hur, ruler of Ahasuerus' district of Jerusalem, repaired the next section. Adjoining this, Jedidiah, son of Harumaph, made repairs opposite his house, and Hattush, son of Hashabniah, made repairs next to him. Malchijah, son of Harim, and Hashub, son of Pahadi Moab, repaired another section in the Tower of the Ovens. Shalom, son of Halasheth, ruler of the half-district of Jerusalem, repaired the next section with the help of his daughters. You know, the thing that we need to understand in this is that everybody was involved in the mission. That there was no one who was exempt from the mission. Everyone had a part to play. And as we look at all these families and different people from different levels in their culture, in their society, different jobs, women, everyone was involved in the mission. And it's true about us as a church. Everyone has a part to play. Everyone is responsible. Maybe not for the very same thing, but everyone is responsible and involved in the mission. You know, it's kind of interesting when it goes through the different occupations there, and they had a perfume maker in Jerusalem. And I was thinking about that, you know, my goodness, the walls have fallen down. You know, the people are in poverty and hunger, and this place is a mess, and they got some guy selling perfume. Well, I think, as you think about it, it seems pretty evident what it is. There wasn't any water. There wasn't any water. It was probably a pretty smelly place. The perfume maker probably was a pretty profitable business at that time. But the point is that everyone, no matter what their level in society, they were involved in the mission. And every one of you had been called to be part of the mission. There's nothing you can say that exempts you from the mission. God's desire is to include you in that in some way. Find out what your part to play is, and to step into that and to do it. I tell you, I got a special place in my heart, though, for Shalom, the guy who brings his daughters out to work. You know, to Shalom and his daughters. And I Shalom. You know, he probably didn't have sons. He either had sons who just were too lazy to work, or he only had daughters, which I think is probably the case. And he said, come on, girls, we're going to work. And they were right there alongside Dad and probably Mom, working on the wall, working on the gate. And that is what we're all... It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter how gifted, how superior your intellect. God has a part for you to play in the mission, rebuilding the walls. No one was left out. And God doesn't want any of us left out either. If we return to Nehemiah chapter 3, looking at verse 13... The valley gate was repaired by Hanun and the residents of Zenoa. They rebuilt it and put its doors and bolts and bars in place. They also repaired 500 yards of the wall as far as the dung gate. The dung gate was repaired by Malkijah, son of Rechab, ruler of the district of Beth Hakerem. He rebuilt it and put its doors and bolts and bars in place. The dung gate? How'd you like to draw that? Okay, Cornelius family, you got the dung gate. Really? Can we put our name on it? I mean, you know, think about it. You know, and the dung gate was really what it says. There were 7 gates around Jerusalem. The dung gate led out to the garbage dump. It led into Gehenna, if you've ever heard that term. The constant burning pile of rubbish outside the city. And the dung gate would be opened, and that's where they would take all the garbage. That's where they would take all the rubbish. And it would go out through there. And someone had to be responsible to rebuild the dung gate. And this family was called to that. And the point is this, and that is that some aspects of mission and the mission that they had to face were not as glamorous. Some maybe they didn't really want to be involved in, but every one of them were equally important. Do you know, there were, as I said, there were 7 gates to the city of Jerusalem. Now I ask you this question. Which one would have been the most important in keeping the city secure? Every one of them were equally important. You know what? It wouldn't matter if the main palace gate was bolted, secure, 8 feet thick, 30 feet high. If the dung gate wasn't in place, the city wasn't safe. Every aspect of that wall was important. Every part of the mission that needed completed was equally important to the safety and security of the city. And we could look around our church and we could look at things that just aren't that glamorous, aren't that exciting, just don't look like that much fun. And we could say, you know what, that, you know, well, that's just that. It's just as important as every other part. Every aspect of the mission is important, because when one piece of it is not in place, the rest of it suffers. And you know what? Whatever it is you've been called to do, whatever it is that God desires for you, it's important. Do it. Don't look at the task that God has given you and think, well, it's just this. I only got this to do. It is equally important in the overall mission that God has given us as a church. The building up of His church requires, it's a one big task, but it requires many little tasks. It requires many people, each doing their part to bring that about. And the city of Jerusalem, it was the same way. The dung gate was just as important as any other gate. It would make the city safe and secure as much as any other gate would. It was required. It was necessary. And we need to understand that about mission in the church. There is no unimportant missions. There's nothing that's not that important. It's all important. And whatever it is that you've been called to do, do it to the best of your ability. Pour yourself completely into it. Bring glory and honor to God as a result of the mission that God has given you. Work at your section of the wall with all the passion that you could possibly muster up. Turning back to verse 15, we're going to read through verse 27. It says, the fountain gate was repaired by Shallan, son of Kol-Hoze, ruler of the district of Mizpah. He rebuilt it, roofing it over and putting its doors and bolts and bars in place. He also repaired the wall of the Pool of Siloam by the king's garden as far as the steps going down from the city of David. Beyond him, Nehemiah, son of Azbuk, ruler of the half district of Beth-Zur, and that's a different Nehemiah, made the repairs to a point opposite the tombs of David, as far as the artificial pool and the house of the heroes. Next to him, the repairs were made by the Levites under Rehum, son of Bani. Beside him, Hashabiah, ruler of the half-district of Keilah, carried out repairs for his district. Next to him, the repairs were made by their countrymen under Binui, son of Henadad, ruler of the half-district of Kalai. Next to him, Ezer, son of Jeshua, ruler of Mizpah, repaired another section from a point facing the ascent to the armory as far as the angle. Next to him, Baruch, son of Zebiah, zealously repaired another section. I like that. This guy was zealously repairing his section. From the angle to the entrance of the house of Eliashib, the high priest. Next to him, Meremoth, son of Uriah, the son of Hakoz, repaired another section from the entrance of Eliashib's house to the end of it. The repairs next to him were made by the priests from the surrounding region. Beyond them, Benjamin and Hashub made repairs in front of their house and next to them. Azariah, son of Mashiach, the son of Ananiah, made repairs beside his house. Next to him, Benui, son of Henadad, repaired another section from Azariah's house to the angle in the corner. And Pahel, son of Uzziah, worked opposite the angle and the tower projecting from the upper palace near the court of the guard. Next to him, Padiah, son of Parosh, and the temple servants living on the hill of Ophel made repairs up to the point opposite the water gate toward the east and the projecting tower. Next to them, the men of Tekoa repaired another section from the great projecting tower to the wall of Ophel. You notice a name in there that you may have recognized, and that was the men of Tekoa. And there were some other ones that were mentioned in there. They were men who had completed their particular part. I don't want to say men, people who had completed their responsibility. They had been given a particular task. This is your part of the wall. Fix it. And when they fixed it, they went someplace else and they helped them repair their part of the wall. And I'm telling you, you just got to admire these men of Tekoa. This was not their hometown. This was not the place that they lived. They weren't dependent upon this for anything. They just wanted to see honor and glory return to God. And so when they finished what was their responsibility, they went and they found somebody else who needed help. And they joined in. They worked not only to complete their own task, but to help others accomplish theirs. They could have easily finished what was assigned to them and said, you know what, I'm heading home. I've done my time. I've done my responsibility. I'm out of here. But they didn't. They finished what was their responsibility and they went and they looked to find somebody else that they could help. You know what? They could have easily pointed fingers. They could have said, you know what? These guys have been goofing off. They haven't put any effort into this. They're halfway done and we're finished already. You know, let them just bear the consequence of that. And you know what they did? They went and they helped them. You know what? Instead of pointing fingers, instead of looking at people who aren't giving their all and maybe being accusatory or blaming, you know, why don't we think about going alongside people and saying, how can I help you? You want to encourage people? Then step into their life. Step alongside them. Don't point at you and say, look, you made this mess or you haven't done what you need to do. Go into their life and begin helping them rebuild. And that's what the people of Tekoa did. It's what Meremoth and his people did. Go down the list. There were many people who did that. They finished what was their responsibility and then they helped somebody else to get through it, to complete what they were called to do also. The church needs people who are willing to focus on the overall mission, because that's it. When we worry only about our little task, and I don't say little task meaning, you know, to minimize it, but when we look at our just part that we have to play and we focus completely on that, we forget that our part is only one part in a huge, huge overall mission. If we want the overall mission to be completed, then every aspect of the wall is important. Not only the part that I did, but the part that you're doing. And if I can help you to do your part better, then so be it. Let me step in alongside you and help you with that. We need to focus on the overall mission as opposed to completely focusing on our own small part of the mission. Turn back to Nehemiah chapter 3, starting at verse 28. It says, above the horse gate, the priests made repairs, each in front of his own house. Next to them, Zadok, son of Immer, made repairs opposite his house. Next to him, Shemaiah, son of Shechaniah, the guard of the east gate, made repairs. Next to him, Hananiah, son of Shelemiah, and Hanun, the sixth son of Zalaph, repaired another section. Next to them, Meshullam, son of Berechiah, made repairs opposite his living quarters. Next to him, Malchijah, one of the goldsmiths, made repairs as far as the house of the temple servants and the merchants opposite the inspection gate, and as far as the room above the corner. And between the room above the corner and the sheep gate, the goldsmiths and merchants made repairs. You know, when you look at this picture, you see that generally speaking, the part of the wall that the family was responsible for was the part of the wall that stood in front of their home. It was the part of the wall that they would be protected behind. And so, in this way of building and repairing, the primary responsibility of the workers was in proximity to their own homes. It's where you lived. It's where you were close. That's your responsibility. And I want us to understand today that your primary responsibility as parents, and especially as husbands, your primary mission is your own home. Your first and foremost responsibility is your family and your children. That's the mission that is most critical to you today. That doesn't mean that the rest of your mission is not important, that you cast it aside and forget it. But the most important mission that you have is that of those that live in your home with you. Those family members, those kids. Your family is your primary responsibility. That is the mission that is most important to you. But there's another aspect in here that we don't want to miss. And that is that the part of the wall that was going to protect them was the part of the wall that they were working on. And when you complete your mission, and I'm not talking about your mission to your family, but when you are completing, when you are working at the mission, the overall mission that God has made you a part of, you are building, you are strengthening the wall that your family will stand behind. You know, today, as we look at our nation and we see some things that are very troubling and some indications that it's crumbling from within, look, you can do something about that. And as you pour into the mission, God's mission for this nation, you will strengthen the wall that your children will stand behind. And the people of Jerusalem understood that. I'll tell you what, when I understand that the wall that I'm working on is going to determine whether or not I survive the attack, it puts a whole new emphasis into the work I put into that wall. If I really believe that the wall is going to have to withstand the attack that is coming against me and my family, I am going to make that the best wall I could possibly build. And yet today, oftentimes we neglect that as dads, as moms, as families. And as we finish this final point today, I want to encourage us to that. Guys, pour yourself into building the wall, the spiritual wall that are going to protect your children. You know, if we could understand, if we could see spiritually, that we, if we could understand that, see it in the reality of a wall that's physically protecting us, and turn that into the spiritual understanding that God's trying for us, trying us to get us to understand, and that is that the wall you build and the strength of God in your life is going to be what protects you and your family. We would approach that building in a whole different way. It wouldn't be just something that we slap together. It wouldn't be just a little lean-to. It would be a fortress. And I want us as a church to see it that way also. We have an incredible, important mission to complete as a body of believers. Whatever part of the wall that God has given you, pour yourself in to reinforcing, to building, to strengthening that wall, and that is going to build the entire mission. It's going to help complete the entire mission. It was the mold that Nehemiah used, and it's still applicable to us today. Guys, we've been given an incredible mission. We have been given the responsibility of, we're looking at a culture where the walls are falling. The families are in disrepair. Things are in shambles. And the only hope is to build as God intended for it to be built. And if we as a church understand that and take that mission, I'm not talking about building a fortress around this little church. I'm talking about taking it to the streets of our world, of our culture. God will begin a great work in this church. Find out you're part of the wall. Earnestly, zealously work on your part of the wall. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the story of Nehemiah. We thank you, God, that you've given us this beautiful picture of what it means to complete a mission. And Lord, as we as a church consider how it would be that you would want us to move forward, what walls it would be that you want us to repair, God, that we would use the truths in this scripture to complete that task. Help us, Lord, to faithfully do whatever it is we've been called to do. And I pray for every person who sits in here, Lord, that we would each and every one of us identify the part of the wall we are responsible for, and God, we would zealously work to fix that part of the wall. We thank you. We praise you. And we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you all stand as we close today?
You know, as Dan was speaking this morning and he was talking about the story of Nehemiah, and he eventually brought it around to this point, but the story of Nehemiah is about the mission, and it's about the church, but it's also about us as individuals. And I couldn't help but think about how that one of the things that this story is so applicable to is the relationships that we have and people that we come in contact with every day. I know, just reminded, a couple years ago I had a student that I was covering a class for another teacher, and basically broke up a fight. And as I was disciplining the two students, one of them just started using some of the most vile language that you can imagine, came out of her mouth directed towards me because I just happened to be the one that was intervening. And she continued to scream obscenities and just violent hatred speech the whole way down the hall to the office. And I was obviously very upset by that, and I was very angry about that. And for the last 2 years, I would see this student, and she would obviously avoid me. She would just go the other way when she saw me coming. And I mentioned it to one of her friends here not too long ago, that I said, I know that this student doesn't like me, and she thinks that I don't like her. And I said, that's not true. I said, I don't dislike her at all. And they went and shared that with her. And just this past week, down at the Bob Lenz concert, she came up to me and she said, I want to tell you that I'm sorry for what I said to you. And I said, well, I said, I appreciate that and I accept that. But I said, I want you to know that I forgave you a long time ago. A long time before tonight, I forgave you for what you did. And I said, you need to know that. You know, I think that part of the reason, just like she avoided me, I think the reason that we avoid other people is because we think the same way that she did. Because she was not going to say anything to me because she didn't deserve me to be nice to her. And when we come in contact with people and the people in our relationships that we're close to, whether it's a husband or wife, whether it's somebody we work with, whether it's a friend, oftentimes they do things or they say things that we don't deserve, or they don't deserve for us to forgive them, or they don't deserve for us to be nice to them. But we're going to close with a song here called Jesus Messiah, and it starts off by saying, He became sin who knew no sin. You see, for me not to be able to forgive somebody who has done something horrible to me, it would be just like Jesus, if I would come to Him and say to me, you don't deserve my forgiveness. And I don't. I don't deserve the forgiveness that Jesus offers. There's not one shred in me that gives me any reason to believe that I deserve for Jesus to forgive me. But you know, that same thing is true about each one of us in the relationships that we're involved in. We don't deserve for that person. I don't deserve for my wife to forgive me when I do something to hurt her. None of us are deserving of those things. But we need to give people the same grace that Jesus gave us when He came and died on the cross for us, because not one of us is deserving of those things. So I'd like to just challenge you this morning as we close with this song, that we sing Jesus Messiah, remember what it was that Jesus did for you, and be willing to lay down those things that get in the way of you being able to truly love other people. Because you see, we can't give what we don't have. We don't have a relationship with Jesus, we can't give that same love to other people. And if our relationship with Christ isn't what it should be, even if we are a Christian, we still cannot give what we need to give to other people. So I just challenge you this morning, just if you're struggling with something, you're carrying weight around, that you would just lay it down and give it to Him. He can do great and mighty things through you if you only let Him. Jesus Messiah.
Messiah, Lord of all. blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel.
The gospel is very clear. It's very simple. It just says that our sin separates us from God. That the sin in our life makes it impossible for us to enter into His presence. But God sent His Son, Jesus Christ, to come to this earth to die on a cross. And if we believe in Him, simply believe in Him, He'll save us. What does that mean? It means that the direction you're going right now, you turn, you head straight towards God. You head straight towards Jesus, and He'll come into your life. He'll save you. And He will make you immediately a part of the rebuilding process. If you came here today not knowing Christ as your Savior, as we pray here in just a moment, I just ask you, just where you stand, you just bow your head, you close your eyes, and you just ask God today to forgive you and to accept you into His arms. That you trust in the work that Jesus did, and He'll save you. Let's pray together. Father, we thank You that You are a rebuilding God. And that, Lord, no matter what shape we walked into here today, whether we are a building half built, whether we are a building nearly completed, or God, if we stand in a pile of rubble, God, You are the one who can fix that. I pray, Lord, that if there is anyone here today who does not know You as their Savior, that they simply today repent and turn to You, asking for Your forgiveness. God, at that moment, You will save them, and we praise You for that. Lord, for those who are standing half built, I pray, God, that You help us to find our responsibility, the part that You have for us to play in this rebuilding process. And God, that we will focus on that for Your glory, for Your purposes, for Your honor. And that, Lord, in that, our mission will be clear and our mission will be completed. We thank You, Lord. We praise You. And we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you as you go from here today. And just remind you that we're having a get-together over here, celebration. Join us.